Investor's Edge with Gary Kaltbaum. Straight talk about you and your money. Now from the BizTalk studios, here is Gary Kaltbaum.
And welcome once again to Investor's Edge. I'm Gary Kaltbaum, your host. Thanks for being with us today. Glad you're here, ladies and gentlemen. Happy that you are listening. It's February 21st, 2024. Hope you're having a good day. If you do not get this radio show in your city, we'll post it at GaryK.com. We'll also post it on our Twitter feed, which is now X. And if you don't follow us on Twitter, you really should, because we are very charming and sarcastic. And if you want to email me, you may. Just be nice. Okay? We're nice. By the way, we found out who the guy who was telling me I'm such a liar about everything, and we put out the bet to the person. It's my buddy that doesn't like me anymore because I'm not a Trump guy, I guess. Anyway, such is life. And just so you know, this is serious talk on everything that affects you. And I mean everything. The markets, the economy, jobs, unemployment, taxes, deficit spending, scams, shams, corruption, the control freak in the White House, who, by the way, you may not know this, and you will not feel it. Specifically, you will not feel it. But the president today just took credit for giving about another $1.5 billion to people that had student loans for 10 years and are below $12,000. So let's say you've had a student loan and you've been paying it off, or this is where you're at. He is saying how he has given those people that reprieve. Just remember, it is us given the reprieve. We're nothing but a big, gigantic slush fund for these people to do their bidding. And it's not just reserved for the control freak in the White House. It's been all the control freaks in the White House over the many years. This guy just has the big-time championship belt. Just remember, government doesn't have a freaking dime. It's all our money that goes to them. They do not produce profits. And when they realize, well, wait a minute, hold on, all right, so they sent us $3 trillion bucks, screw that, we want to spend $4 trillion, they just went to deficits and deficits and deficits and deficits to the tune of, just think about this, $34 trillion over and above what they were supposed to spend. And by the way, $26 trillion of it since 2008. So Obama, started it. Obama. You know, that great president, Obama. I want you to think about that. And then we go to, and again, my point, Donald Trump, who I remember so well. So well, him telling us, oh, I wrote the book, The Art of the Deal, and I understand debt and all that. I'm a genius, and it will be so easy to lower it. And the first thing he did is he walked in and raised spending $600 billion a year, which continues every year, and he ran up trillions, which gave rise to this guy. And do you know why most Republicans don't complain about this guy in the debt and the deficits? Just a few. The reason why is because if they take power next, they're going to do the same. So, as I have stated, imagine if you went to your bank account today and all of a sudden you see a debit of $200, and next to it was a little journal that says student loan payment. But wait a minute, I don't have a student loan. No, it's a student loan payment for somebody else's student loan. Imagine if that's what occurred. Do you think they would get away with it? Hell no. But they get away with it because they know it specifically right now doesn't affect you. It just goes into the slush fund. And since it's $34 trillion now, what's another $1 trillion? Who gives a crap about another trillion when it's already $34 trillion? And that's what's happened here. It's maniacal. And as I have told you, they keep telling us how good the economy is and the GDP. It's government. They keep telling us about employment. The amount of government jobs has skyrocketed. They have created this gargantuan blob that never ends. And anybody who tries to cut it at the knees is kicked in the grapefruits. And trust me when I say this. Trump, if he wins, his new thing is, oh, well, we're going to produce a crap load of oil and we're going to sell it and we're going to pay down debt. No, he's not. And when it blows up, not if, they each blame each other and we're screwed. Remember 08. We didn't cause 08. The government caused 08. The central bank keeping rates too low for too long created this ridiculous housing bubble. And they sat there like a bunch of dummies. The bubble pops because Wall Street, their buddies, margin mortgage-backed securities with all kinds of weird letters, CDOs, CMOs, MOUSE. And they went 5-1 and 10-1 and 15-1 and 21. And then they had the collusion of the rating services. You know those rating services, Fitch and Moody's and all them? Do you know what they did? They rated stuff that should have been rated triple Z, triple A. Their actual emails between them saying this is a bunch of dog something. They didn't use the word crap. You had Goldman Sachs create these products, create them. They created them and then sold them and shorted their own products. If I did that, I'm going to jail. Guess what they got? Oh, one guy went to be a Treasury secretary. Nobody got in trouble, not one indictment, no nothing. And how do I get to this point, by the way? Because he just forgave another $1.5 billion, and they just, money grows on trees. That's all it comes down to. The money frickin' grows on trees. It just goes into the journal of the slush fund that's now $34 trillion, to where our interest payments are nearing $1 trillion a year, and that's going to keep growing. And we're going to go to $40 trillion. We're going to go to $45 trillion. We're going to go to $50 trillion. It's all going to blow up. I don't know in what form, what it takes. I know the markets aren't going to like it. And then they're going to curse each other out. It's all your fault. No, it's your fault. It's your fault. And we're the ones screwed. And nobody listens to me because, well, wait a minute, Gary. Haven't you been saying this since $25 trillion? No, you damn straight I have. But in its simplest form, ladies and gentlemen, if you make 50 grand a year and you got 5 grand in the bank, let's say you make now 80 grand a year and you have 20 grand in the bank and somebody sends you a credit card with 20,000 bucks on it and you spend it all and you can't afford to pay that card. Oh, but you can pay 100 bucks a month. But then you're stupid enough because you get another credit card for $40,000, so you pay off the $20,000 and you spend the $40,000. And what happens if you just keep getting cards, credit cards with a bigger credit limit to pay the last one off? What if that keeps going on? What if that happens? You tell me. You tell me. That's all they're doing. And they all know they're going to be dead or retired. So they don't give a crap, not one of them. He gave $1.5 billion of our tax dollars away today to people that actually signed the contract to pay off a loan. And what he's doing is saying, hey, hey, vote for me. Look what I'm doing for you. We were warned by Jefferson more than two centuries ago about these people, Joe Biden on down. And we sit here and there's nothing we can do about it. Because the words "we the people" are gone. History evaporated. They're evaporated into "they the government." We are their dupes. We are their nothings. And they look at us and they told us campaign finance reform and said they opened the spigots. Do you read how much they're spending on the presidential election this year? Billions! You remember that wasn't supposed to be. Remember campaign finance reform, the other scam. Up next, we'll put a bow on it. And I'm kind of wasting time a little bit here because we're waiting on NVIDIA and much more. I'm Gary. This is the one and only Investor's Edge.
Hi, I'm Gary Kaltbaum, host of the nationally syndicated radio show Investor's Edge. We're not just handsome radio people. We manage investors' money for a living, specializing in fee-based discretionary money management. No big commissions, just a fee on the assets that's managed. We also provide a full range of personalized services, including retirement planning, fixed income, and educational needs, all to assist you in achieving your financial goals. Understanding not all individuals have the same needs, we'll carefully evaluate your personal goals to determine a proper investment strategy. If your current approach to investing is not getting you to where you would like to be, call us to make an appointment for a complimentary portfolio review. The number to call is 888-422-5559. That's 888-422-5559. That's 888-422-5559. Investment advisory services offered through Kaltbaum Capital Management.
It's time to switch on the integrator units and get the brain cells working.
You're listening to...
Hey, this promises to be fun.
Investor's Edge.
The last bastion of quality programming.
With Gary Kaltbaum.
It doesn't get better than this.
Think about everything I'm telling you. Think about it. They keep telling us about how to live our lives within our means and this and that. And they don't follow suit. You know who is the most hated person of our government? Has to be Dave. You know Dave Ramsey? He's the guy who says, cut your credit cards, don't have debt. Imagine if Dave Ramsey took over the government. Oh, would they be pissed? He's right. You know, we don't do it that often. But your biggest enemy is the credit card if you don't know how to handle it. I've never paid a dime of interest on a credit card. I pay it off every month. And the credit cards never used to put on there, well, if you pay the minimum amount, you're going to pay this off in 38 years. So they had to put that on there. I still think that's still on there, though. I'm not 100% sure. Joe Biden had a chance. But this creep, this corrupt family, the year before COVID, our federal government spent $4.4 trillion. If he just kept it there, we wouldn't have deficits this year. But he raised spending to 6.7. The spending this year is going to be more than the COVID years. And the money that's going, where's it going? Into a cesspool. Into a cesspool of incestuous movement. Friends, donors, climate. And all this commentary from me comes from one thing and one thing only. He's given out another $1.5 billion on top of a bunch of others. And the Supreme Court shut this down, and he's still doing it, which takes me to the next two words, executive orders. When the hell has the president been able to just do anything with our tax dollars? It was never supposed to be this way. Just so you know, Congress is supposed to do budgets and spending, not a president. So our government's changed that way also. That's how you get a Donald Trump, by the way, who tells us he's going to change things, but no, he's not. Come on. So, because he took another $1.5 billion of our dollars and gave it to people that signed contracts, you know, you all of you out there that have loans, what do you have to do with that loan? Oh, that's right. You have to pay it back. Do you know why you have to pay it back? Oh, it's because you have a contract. The contract states you pay this back over a certain period of time, a certain amount. Not in Joe Biden's vote-buying world. We'll stop right there. So, just so you know, in my world, I start scanning the market around 3 o'clock into 3:30 and get all done. Well, at 3:20-something, the Dow was down 250. It finished up 48. So it wasn't up big, but it was down 250 and finished up 48. And I have this one screen that has what I call stuff. And basically what the stuff is, well, you got your commodities, housing, transports, airlines, cruise lines, FedEx, UPS, insurance, economically sensitive things like United Rentals or Borg Warner, General Electric. Then I got some medical supplies and stuff. Then I have one big line of retail. I got oils, defense, and whatever. Turned all green by the end of the day. So the Dow was only up 48, but I'm going to tell you that was one damn good comeback. The NASDAQ, which was down about 150 at that time. Let me make sure I got that right before I give you a wrong number. The NASDAQ at the same time, 15,457, was down 172, finished only down 49. A great comeback. The SOX, which was at 43.83, finished at 44.46.63, was down 73, finished only down 10. That's good news. Why is that good news? Well, first off, we have no idea what tomorrow is going to bring. And we're still waiting on NVIDIA's earnings as I speak. The NVIDIA finished down $17 today. It was down like 30 at one time. As we have told you, bearish phases or bear markets will be strong opens, weak closes. Bullish phases have bad opens, weak days, and good closes. Now, it's only one day, but I must say I'm impressed. And you know what I have to do now? I got to rescan all over again because what I'm going to be able to see is stocks that, well, let's say, we're down $5 at 3:30. Finish down one, or maybe some things that were down $3 finishing up one. It really changes what the daily looks like, and that's that. Now, as I speak, it is 4:19 p.m., and I still do not have NVIDIA's earnings. They should have been out by now. I see nothing at this juncture. I'm looking for anything else that may be of movement, and I got nothing, so we'll see if I can get done, or maybe we'll just wait a little bit after this segment, because we do pre-tape this thing, you know I could adjust. But what hasn't changed, solars, yuck. What may be changing, and we've been noting this for you, is China, which now the exchange-traded funds for China are a little sticky now above the declining 50-day moving average, better. The question is, do we trust it? In case you don't know, the latest on China, and by the way, we don't make this up. We tell you what we read. China is now banning major institutional investors from selling stocks at the open or close, and is also now planning to track who is shorting. So in other words, don't be shorting any stocks or you ain't going to be found again. And if nobody can short, shorting, you have to borrow shares and sell. You're selling. It could drop price down. If you're not selling at the close, the finishes are pretty decent. So, China better. And that's the story there. Do I trust? I really don't know if I trust. Up next, NVIDIA's starting to move. We'll let you know what's going on, I think. Thanks for being here. I'm Gary. This is the one and only Investor's Edge.
Listening to
America is talking
Investor's Edge.
He's got to be pleased with that. The crowd is just on his feet here. He's a Cinderella boy.
With Gary Kaltbaum.
Comes highly recommended. You're going to feel better if you talk to him.
And welcome once again to Investor's Edge. By the way, I cried today. As you know, I've been with the Boys and Girls Clubs of Central Florida for over 20 years, inspired by their great work, inspired by a man named Gary Kane, who introduced me to this great organization. And as you know, I am very much neck deep and emotionally involved with the Boys and Girls Clubs of Central Florida. And today we had our annual meeting. They give out awards. I was given out Board Member of the Year for everything I have done over the last 20 years. And they listed a bunch of things. I cannot begin to tell you how proud I am, but I'm nothing compared to the staff and the people that work there. I am just a volunteer on the board that, yes, have done some good things, leave no doubt, and will continue to. But the tireless efforts by these young men and women that, by the way, many of them I'd work for, they're so good and so passionate. Just amazing organization. I could not have been prouder. And Mickey Mouse was there. It was held at the Contemporary Resort at Disney, which, by the way, I've been to Disney World 150 to 200 times in my life. Disney World, Epcot, whatever. But I've only been to Epcot a few times, the other ones a few times, mostly Disney World. I love the place. They really fixed it up good. The entrance to Disney World was always trafficy and stuff. They finally split it off into the hotels and stuff. Really did a good job. Well done. Anyway, just wanted to let you know. Okay, so here's the big story. And by the way, we never make fun of anybody here. Remember that. In my industry, we make fun of nobody. We never laugh at anybody's misfortunes. Why? Because, number one, karma. Number two, it's wrong. The only thing we have done over the last couple of years is we've had to bring up Kathy Wood because the amount of emails we get on her is gargantuan, and the amount of money she has lost yet still has this guru status, we have to explain what's going on. Just so you know, with NVIDIA, there are option players. And when it comes to these hot stocks, they play a lot of risk. What I mean by that is what they will do, they will bet at earnings. So they'll do these short-term options far away from the price right before earnings. So if the stock doesn't move, all these options go to nothing. They go to nothing. And believe it or not, there's a bunch of these options at 1,000, 1,100, 1,200. What? Are these people insane? The stock closed today at like 670 something. So if the stock doesn't move, they're screwed. So NVIDIA reports earnings, and as usual, number one, the numbers were gargantuan, but they were expected. Number two, as usual, they beat expectations. It were $4.59 a share. They did 516. Revenues were expected to be 20.40. They came in at 22.1. Going forward, they raised the first quarter. Let's call the midpoint of $24 billion. Expectations were $22.2 billion. The stock in the aftermarket's up $4. And this is a 670-some-odd dollar stock. That's the stock in the aftermarket. Holy crap. So if it stays that way, and of course that can change. It just moved $3 as I said that. But if it just trades a few bucks up or down, all those options will expire worthless, and people are going to lose a hell of a lot of money. Something you won't see your handsome and buffed host ever do, because as we tell you, we have absolutely no clue as to reaction to earnings. Not a frickin' clue. And we don't want to play that game. Now, with NVIDIA, as we have told you, we have sold some down after buying it right on the breakout at 505. We still have what I call an okay-sized position coming into earnings. And we'll see what comes of it tomorrow. After what we have seen in the past week, we just be happy if it does nothing. Because as you know, SMCI, that's Supermicro, is down from $1,072 to $733. Yes, it had a big move, but it's still down $300. And the latest matzo ball, and let me explain me. We very much go over ourselves and what we do or what we do not do. We made a little bit of money in Palo Alto Networks back in like November, December. And then we thought it had topped, and it did. But when we came in and started buying again in early January, we bought Meta, and we're up big on it. We bought NVIDIA, AMD, a couple others, Microsoft. One of the names was Palo Alto Networks that showed itself. We didn't buy it. Went from 300. Actually, if we caught it, we would have bought it somewhere around 318. In the weeks ahead, it hit a high of 381. Before the last few days, the market's been crappy, so it's pulled back. Was down $104 today, as they basically announced not so good, and it took down the whole software security complex. So I went from damn, I am pissed I don't own, to thank you Lord I don't own, welcome to my world. That's the best way I can put it. By the way, not making this up, NVIDIA just went from $674 to $704. Make that $706. That's how quick it can go in the aftermarket as they yap away. We'll see what happens. Back to Palo Alto Networks. In case you don't know, there is the cousin stock theory, which means, oh, you're a big software security company and there's big competition for the biz. Big competition for the biz. Big competition for the biz. So if one's not doing well and has to lower prices, well, CrowdStrike was down $31 today to $292. Zscaler was down $35 to $214. What's this one? How about SentinelOne was down, well, it's a lower price name, down $3.50 to $25.60. How about Checkpoint Software? Not as bad. Down 5 to 154. CyberArk down, oh, that came back a lot, was only down 6 to 244. By the way, not making this up, CyberArk today, let me see if that wasn't a real print, hit 235. So it was down 14 at one time. So thus, that theory. And that's how we got to deal with markets. You never know. By the way, NVIDIA now is 722 in the aftermarket, closed at 674. And just so you know, the original move at 674 had it down to 650 in the aftermarket. And of course, NVIDIA being up will help the semiconductors tomorrow, which could be of import, but we'll see how it finishes. It just dropped $6 in that last sentence. Welcome to the world. And there you go, little aftermarket. And we got a little bit more time. We'll see what happens. But I just see the equipment makers. Let's see. And not up much, but up. And they were all down today. I'm looking to see for anything else. Yeah, AMD's up $4 to 168. So that'll be a help if it sticks, of course. Trust, you never know. And seeing reversals in the aftermarket in other names that have to deal with it. Up next, we'll figure it out. I'm Gary. This is the one and only Investor's Edge.
You're listening to...
What are we waiting for?
Well, what are you waiting for?
One, two, ready, go.
Action! Investor's Edge with Gary Kaltbaum.
So my little semiconductor page is now a bunch of green after being all red, even after the close. NVIDIA, as I speak, is 719, only up 24 today, and it did high of about like 745 recently. But again, that can change. By the way, it's now 724, just moved up $5. Oh, it just moved back $5. Again, we don't make this up. We're telling you what's going on in the aftermarket. I mentioned in the news China. Do I want to trust an area of the world that's banning the free market? That's what China's doing. That said, look what happened when we lost the free market because of J. Powell printing to $9 trillion. The market went straight up. Remember, 2019, October, in the midst of a strong economy and a strong job market, he announced money printing. He said, don't call it money printing, but it was money printing. We came on the show and I said something I would never say. Buy the heck out of the market. He's printing money. And from October to COVID, guess what happened? Straight up. So China's doing this. We'll keep you. The most important thing, as we tell you, it's not the news. It's how things react to the news. It's now trading above the declining 50-day moving average in order to revert from downtrend to potentially uptrend. That's the first thing that has to happen. Doesn't mean it's going to continue, but certain things must happen physically in the market to revert from a downtrend to an uptrend. That would be the first thing. So that was in the news today. Yippee-yay-yay. You know what else is in the news? Have you read what's going on with the migrants and what's going on in New York City. New York City migrant families, just remember, I'm just stating for the record, came here illegally. They can make up to $15,000 per year under a plan that's $53 million in prepaid credit card program. That's what they're thinking of doing. I don't know if they passed it or not. A family of four migrants with two children on the age of 17 could get $15,200 a year under a $53 million program to dole out prepaid credit cards to them, while ignoring the homeless Americans or veterans that are here. I'm just reporting to you the news, and I can tell you there's a lot of pissed off people in these cities that are coming up with freebies for people coming here. By the way, I'm just telling you the truth, that are coming here illegally. Just so you know, it's illegal to cross the border. Did you know that? Did anybody tell you that? They don't tell you that anymore, do they? That's the other great con. And while we talk about that, we just want to let you know, 7 million have now entered the U.S. under this president. Greater than the population of 36 individual states, including Alabama, Colorado, Maryland, Tennessee, Utah, and West Virginia, amongst others. But it's not his fault. Just because he changed everything after he became president, it's not his fault. No, really, it's not his fault. The inflation was the Putin price hike. When inflation came down, it was because of his Inflation Reduction Act, even though he came out and admitted there was nothing about inflation reduction in that act. I couldn't vote this guy for dog catcher. And on the other side is Trump. And by the way, one of his excuses also, Biden, he doesn't have enough money to help the border. The guy who's spending $6.8 trillion of our dollars, about 4 point something in our tax dollars, the rest in debt, says he doesn't have enough money. While he gave $380 billion to John Podesta, a Democratic hack for climate. In the news, electric vehicles. We told you so. It's one of those things we got right. We don't get everything right. In case you don't know, you ever hear the Audi e-tron GT? It was one of the most popular electric vehicles. They're now selling for 20% below the MSRP. They were going for $150,000 and now a lot less. And the used cars are selling for 50% below the MSRP. Also, Ford just cut the price on their Mustang Mach by $8,100, and they were offering 0% finance. Do you know why somebody cuts prices and offers 0% finance? Because they can't sell. Just remember what sales are. You think these retailers are nice? You think they're generous? Hell no. Sales are because demand. Trying to move. If you go to the store and they have 100 yellow shirts and 100 red shirts and the 100 red shirts sell and the 100 yellow shirts are just sitting there, well, the 100 yellow shirts are going to go for half price and they're going to come out with a lot more red shirts at the higher price. That's how it goes. Teaching you a little economics 101, ladies and gentlemen, what's going on with the electric vehicles, brought to you by the government trying to force it up your you-know-what. From people in government that have never run a frickin' business, never wrote a paycheck, never fried a burger, if you fry a burger, or broil it, and have no clue about anything. And that's how you get to $34 trillion bucks of debt. the con continues. As I close, NVIDIA 716 hit a low of 650 in the aftermarket, hit a high of 725. Total for the day up $21, not that much, but closed at 674. So it's up 41 in the aftermarket, about a little less than 6%. But going range bound now, I would guess. Guess what I have to do next? Scan again. You have a great evening. Drive carefully. I'll be on with Varney and Company 10 a.m. tomorrow. Fox Business Network. Don't miss it. And when you get home, do like I do. Quite simple. Make sure you hug your family. Make sure you hug your children. They will feel better. You will feel better. I promise. Thanks for putting up with us. Peace out, all. Good night.
This has been Investor's Edge with Gary Kaltbaum on BizTalk. To listen to past episodes or to get in contact with Gary, go to GaryK.com. That's GaryK.com.